This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the TAPR conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarter's always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive. And I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it. And when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see TAPR DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see TAPR DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. And those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from TAPR. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the TAPR conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the TAPR banquets, TAPR forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a TAPR talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. TAPR and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper talk this is.
Is it working?
It seems to be working.
Okay, all right. So we're next up here. We got the technical issues worked out, hopefully. I'd like to introduce Tim Shepard, KD1KY. His talk is Some Thoughts About Spectrum Regulation, Past, Present, and Future.
Thought I'd let you know what happened to me a week ago, or a couple of weeks ago. I sent an email to Steve saying, hey, I don't see the program on the website, but the early registration deadline is tomorrow. And he said, we've still got a slot in the program. Would you like to give a talk? I was like, okay. So I'm happy to do this. This is a talk I probably should have given 10 years ago, actually. But I've been putting it off, so this has been procrastinating. So, and some of you have heard before, because I've been telling these stories in hallway conversations a lot. And I think some part of this I might have included in the Sunday seminar approximately 15 years ago. I don't remember. That was in Chicago. But anyway, so imagine you and 100,000 of your friends go to a football stadium, a bowl-shaped seating area, and think about the situation there like a spectrum regulator. The acoustic spectrum is only a few kilohertz wide, and it's obvious if you let people talk while they're at the football stadium that there would just be far too much interference and it would destroy the value of that precious resource, the acoustic spectrum, for everyone. Nobody would be able to use it for anything. So we're going to have to pick who can use it, who should use it, and only let them talk. Now, you know that's nonsense, because you can all go to the football stadium and have conversations with your neighbor simultaneously. So that's not quite so. What the spectrum regulator might be worried about is not exactly true. And it's sort of like, well, that's just talking to your neighbor. But actually, there's an important function at the football stadium is the public address system. If we let everybody talk to their neighbors or talk at the same time, and which they can use to communicate with their neighbors, then it obviously wouldn't be possible to engineer an effective public address system for the football stadium. But you know that's nonsense also. You can let everybody talk at once, and yet, at the same time, we can have an effective public address system. Okay, well, that's acoustic. That's fine. Maybe it's different than electromagnetics. And there are actually many ways. I've only got a few listed here, and I couldn't find. Sometime in the last 10 years, I actually made a rather long list, and I've managed to lose it. So the list was much longer, and if you all want to remind me of things I forgot to include on this list, what's the difference between this acoustic case of people's ears and their ability to speak and going to a football stadium versus the electromagnetic situation? They're not the same, so maybe that's what the difference is with a spectrum regulator. Well, our ears are fixed. We can't engineer replacement ears that have different gain or demodulation or whatever. Our voices are pretty much what they are. We don't get a chance to replace them with a more cleverly designed voice transmitter. The protocol we use in talking is pretty much fixed. In other words, our understanding of language. In order to be able to effectively make use of the acoustic spectrum, we have to understand what's being said. That's fixed. In the electromagnetic case, we could have choices on all of these. The acoustic spectrum is only a few kilohertz wide. The electromagnetic spectrum is many gigahertz wide, where we can engineer radio systems. I find this next one the most interesting. The acoustic spectrum, what's going on there is a longitudinal wave. There's just one degree of freedom. The electromagnetic case is a transverse wave. We've got vertical and horizontal polarization. So there's more capacity per hertz in the electromagnetic case than in the acoustic case of bandwidth. So what's interesting about this list, even my longer list that I couldn't find, is that in each case, the differences would argue that the electromagnetic case needs less regulation than the acoustic case, because there's less of a problem of what's going on. Now, this story, I wish I had found this story, I wish I had thought of this story about 10 years earlier than I did, because I did a PhD thesis and wound up working on the scalability of packet radio networks. It was sort of a reaction to a paper that Phil Karn had published in this conference proceedings, late 80s or early 90s. And when I read that paper was Spectral Efficiency Considerations for Packet Radio Networks. And he said a few things in there, and that caused me to think a little bit. And I wound up getting a PhD topic out of it and writing a thesis, and I turned the thesis in, and then actually it got read by people, and it got read by people in the public policy space, because they were concerned that what I had said contradicted their understanding of the fact that spectrum is a precious resource, we only have so much of it, and spectrum can only support so much communication per bandwidth. It has a capacity. And what I was basically pointing out in my thesis seemed arguing that packet radio systems could scale effectively arbitrarily to millions or billions or tens of billions of nodes in a metropolitan area. There seemed to be something going on. And the argument about the capacity of this precious resource is, what about Shannon? Everybody knows Shannon capacity is that for a given bandwidth, B, there's a limited amount of capacity that bandwidth can support. And the spectrum regulators are allocating bandwidth, and, well, however much bandwidth they allocate to somebody, that's how much capacity that they're going to... There's a linear relationship between how much capacity you can get. What's missing? Shannon's capacity theorem is about this picture. It's absolutely true, but it's about that. What's missing in this diagram that's in my 100,000 people in the football stadium story? Spatial reuse. But why does that, what is it? Yes, that's in some sense exactly right, but what is it about my stadium story that's not in this picture? Shout it out, I can't.
The inverse square law.
Yeah, you guys are jumping way ahead. There's something very simple and fundamental. Yeah, that happens in what? Space, which is three-dimensional. What's missing from Claude Shannon's story in his wonderful breakthrough 1948 paper is any notion of a three-dimensional physical world in which these communication systems are embedded. His capacity theorem is absolutely true, but it's per degree of freedom, is what I heard someone say once. You get that much capacity per degree of freedom in your communication system. Every time somebody adds a new antenna in the three-dimensional physical world, that's another degree of freedom, and the communication that can be received down that antenna is limited by Shannon's capacity theorem. That's why MIMO, which was also developed in the late 90s, and I didn't know about it until I was done with my work, MIMO is the sort of incredible thing that is, if you add more antennas to your transmitter and add more antennas to your receiver, and take the power you would have transmitted across one antenna and spread it across the multiple antennas and have the multiple antennas at the receiver, and you have enough signal processing capacity at that receiver to combine it all back together, you actually get, I believe, it's a you get to multiply by the number of antennas that you deployed at both ends, the capacity, without adding power. That's sort of amazing. So I'm telling a story here that argues that perhaps we don't need all this regulation of the radio spectrum, given our understanding of what's going on. Or maybe we don't need it. Maybe we need strictly less regulation of the radio spectrum than the acoustic spectrum. And that's a very radical thing to say, and it actually scares me. But I believe it. So why do we need regulation of the radio spectrum? Well, back up 100 years, why did they start regulating the radio spectrum? No, it predates World War I. It's, one word, interference. There was a problem of interference. So why was there a problem of interference? What is interference? And that's perhaps what we should think about first. What is interference? Step all the way back away from radio technology, which is probably what you're all thinking of. Can you explain what interference is or define what it is without thinking about radio interferences, which is what this audience probably thinks of, what you probably do. What is interference? Interference is a phenomena studied by economists. Two automobiles interfere with each other in the sense that you can't put two of them in the same parking spot at the same time. They physically interfere with each other. There's an exclusive relationship to them. So, do radio signals interfere with each other? They do not. Radio waves in the three-dimensional physical world pass through each other with zero interaction. Physicists might say a photon-photon interaction, a photon-photon cross-section is zero. And I believe that's true for all energy levels that we might care about. It might not be true at super high energy levels. But anyway. But we all know that radio interference is real. We know this because, I mean, we operate on bands. We know exactly what it's like. What is going on? Why do we experience radio interference? Radio interference, if it occurs, happens entirely within the receiving apparatus. And it depends almost entirely on the receiver. If you have a victim receiver that's trying to receive a signal from a given transmitter, and there's another transmitter that is also radiating, and because that other transmitter is radiating, and you're a victim of interference from that other transmitter, I believe it is always the case, though maybe ridiculously expensive, but it is always the case that you could leave the two transmitters unchanged and replace the receiver with a different receiver that could receive the intended transmitter and not be interfered with by that other interfering transmitter. You know, the first thing you should think of, and you're probably already thinking of, is directional gain. But that's only one of many options that a that the engineer designing that receiver might be able to play with. So, actually, this is something I wish I'd thought of, and it gets back to the directional gain. If you think some radios are interfering with each other with the receiver you have, in other words, you take your receiver out and say, yep, with my receiver, these two radio signals are interfering with each other, you are undersampling in three-dimensional space. And it was David Reed that told me this. He actually came up with this when he was working at Interval Research. I believe this was sometime between 15 and 20 years ago. Interval Research was funded by one of the Microsoft founders, who I forget, sorry, I don't remember the name, but anyway, it was almost like a think tank, and they were doing all sorts of interesting stuff in all sorts of different fields. And David Reed moved from the East Coast out to California, worked for them for a while, and thought about a lot of this as well, and helped me think through some of this after I finished my thesis. So, another way of thinking about this is we're actually already familiar with electromagnetic waves that where we don't actually think they need regulation, and that's light. In light, you can use optical techniques. In fact, the optical frequency receivers that we carry around with us in our head, our eyes, are imaging receivers. We actually can tell when a photon comes to us. We can actually tell with a fairly high precision exactly what direction that particular signal came in. And we can't do this with radio waves. Certainly a century ago, the radio spectrum that they were cared about regulating was from long wavelengths down to some of the shorter wavelengths that were only hundreds of meters. And if you think about what it would take to build an imaging receiver for those wavelengths, it would be planet scale. Maybe someday we might build an array on the other side of the moon so that we can try looking at distant things, build a radio telescope in the 1,000 meter band or something. But obviously in long wave and medium wave bands, we can't build imaging receivers. It's even hard to build a directional array to get even just a little bit of directional gain. At optical frequencies, the only thing you can do is optical techniques. You can't build a phased array of electromagnetic sensors like we think of in radio. So there's a difference in wavelength here. Radio waves, as when we started regulating spectrum, the wavelengths were hundreds of meters, and light is hundreds of nanometers. And so the interesting question is where should the transition be from radio wave regulation, like what they came up with 100 years ago to solve the problem of medium wave and long wave spectrum and how it's used, to light? And we've not gotten to halfway on a log scale. We haven't gotten quite there yet, but we've gotten about a third of the way there, if I've done my arithmetic right. So it seems like perhaps this is just something to think about. I haven't figured out exactly what the right thing to do. Anyway, these thoughts have been bouncing around in my head for a while, and I've been thinking I should get up in front of an audience and speak more about this. But what about the real world we live in and all the radios we use and love and play with and depend on, and society depends on for various things? I actually don't think they got it wrong a century ago, given the technology available at the time, and also the wavelengths. Even today, for medium wave and long wave, I don't think we can do anything different in regulation, much different than what we sort of have. So the idea that you should think of this resource as spectrum, that's, you know, there's one scale and you divide it up and do something with it. But what about, I think they did pretty much the right thing. But what about now, and what about a century from now? Actually, I don't think for medium wave and long wave and even HF, and maybe low VHF and maybe even high VHF, there's probably not a lot that should be different. But certainly as the wavelengths get shorter, I mean, the wavelengths we use every day in these portable phones that we carry around with us, which are like supercomputers and on the internet and everything, they're using wavelengths that are quite a bit shorter. And if you've actually kept your eye on the antennas at cell phone sites that they're putting up, the sort of extent of the phased arrays that they're installing are getting bigger. And that's so they can do things which are getting closer to the way, you know, optical. It's not really, they're not using optical techniques, they're using phased arrays and stuff. But they're using directional gain, they're using as many processing gain tricks as they can pull out. And it seems to me that that we're at least above some frequency, we're going to get to the point where engineers can build reliable communication systems, reliable navigation systems, and reliable radar systems without protection from interference via government regulation of the spectrum. And if that's true at some point, why regulate it all? And how soon will technology get there? Is this something we can do today with technology that's available today? I saw at least one head bouncing up and down as a yes. I've had people who are better radio engineers than I am by a long ways tell me that, oh, it's absolutely true today. Actually, if you think about the military has been worried about this since about World War II, because when they go into the battlefield, they can't cry to the government regulator when someone interferes with their systems. They also can launch radiation-seeking missiles at the sources of interference that are annoying them. We can't quite do this in polite society. But it seems like with technology advancing, I mean, what allows a radio engineer to pull this off, this sort of fantasy of no regulation, oh, part of this deal of turning the radio engineer loose is telling them, oh, by the way, and you can radiate anywhere you want. You don't have to, or at least there are very wide swaths of spectrum where you can put up any kind of signals you want. Then some people believe they can pull that off today. You can't actually pull it off today because of the regulation in some cases, but maybe even with today's regulation, you can pull it off. And what I think is going forward, I think we ought to deregulate as much as possible, because I'd like to build systems. I like to play with things and stuff that I can't quite do in the ham bands for various reasons. And one of the reasons we can't do this sort of thing right away is that there are deployed systems that were engineered with the assumption that you would have protection from interference from by government regulation. And one of the things I thought of a while ago, and actually I realized they're actually sort of already doing this. Historically, licenses have had bundled. When you get a license, you get both a permission to radiate, transmit, and you also get a legal protection from interference. It'd be nice if permission to transmit didn't necessarily come with as much or any protection from interference to encourage deployment of the receiving technologies that can actually get the signal out even in the face of what other receivers would think of interference. And we've got actually a fairly good example now deployed over the past 20-something years. Everybody uses Wi-Fi, and there's no licensing of putting up access points. You could say, well, they're low power, and that's sort of true, but the problem of deploying Wi-Fi access points in large, dense office buildings is quite a mess, and a lot of effort has gone into this, and this is the difference between the $50 access point that you can buy at a discount electronics store and the corporate model access points that are sold for $1,000 or even maybe twice that or something. They really are different and better and have all sorts of engineering inside them to make them work better. And maybe the price of you know, all of that engineering that goes in to make them work better in highly densely packed buildings, you know, maybe some of that technology can get down to the cheaper ones and cheaper things. And all of the installed base in other bands, for it, not so much talking about Wi-Fi now, but you know, the reason we can't, like a very important band to not interfere with is 108 to 118 megahertz. Because that's the part of the aviation VHF band that is used for the VORs and the left-to-right localizer for an instrument landing system. And it's technology that's more than 50 years old, and it is very sensitive to interference. That's a lot. That's an expensive installed base that would be very difficult to replace, and that's probably one of the things that's going to need protecting for the longest, actually. I expect 20 years from now, they're still going to be using that same left-to-right localizer on the instrument landing systems. But there are many other examples. Just think of any system you want. The receivers that are deployed in that system that would, in fact, experience interference if we let people willy-nilly start transmitting other kinds of signals out there. That's an installed base. It's an economic investment that we shouldn't damage. And if we're going to make any changes, it's going to have to be something that takes place over decades. This vision of maybe no regulation at all needed anymore, I think, is sort of a 100-year thing. A century from now, perhaps we won't need any government regulation of the radio spectrum. So, what about amateur radio? This is one of the things that made me sad. I don't operate much. My HF station is in a bag. It's a 20-meter dipole and a Yaesu 817, which has worked quite well a few times when I've strung it up between trees. But actually, most of the time when I actually go and operate, did not do it last weekend, but I've often gone and worked the VHF contests. And I love that. The weak signal work. The few times from the East Coast, 6 meters opens, and I get these little short QSOs with like several dozen stations with six calls. And occasionally we get meteor scatter openings in the band, and they're rare. I mean, typically I'll go several years between having one of these thrilling moments. In between those, we work all sort, you know, the VHF contest station I work on has the bottom six or seven bands, so we've got a fairly nice dish that we use in the upper bands, and I love that weak signal stuff. And I think actually that ought to get preserved. And the way I think of it, the ham radio bands ought to be the national parks of the radio spectrum, where you can go enjoy living a more primitive life, like camping. You learn something from camping, which is valuable in this modern society where, you know, sort of like if you didn't have the air conditioning and the heat and the indoor plumbing and the kitchen and the microwave oven in the kitchen, it's like, how would you survive? Well, it's actually nice to learn about things. And I think one of the most important contributions, and I think often amateur radio, they talk about the public service aspect of it. I think the most, this is, in some sense, a personal story, that reason amateur radio was so important to me is it was an important part of the start of my education in electronics. I started out as an electronics hobbyist, and it was about when I was 8 or 9 years old, I started getting interested in amateur radio, and I think it took me like 3 or 4 years before I got my novice license. But I was listening to amateur radio operators on a little tiny multiband radio. Couldn't quite understand the single sideband because I didn't have a beat frequency oscillator, but I could tell they were there, and I could tell they were talking. I could listen to the shortwave broadcasters as well. I could hear the Morse code just fine. There was no BFO, so it was no tone, but I could tell that it was Morse code. It was all too fast for me. But that was my interest, and it remained an interest of mine all the way through high school, undergrad, graduate school, and even after graduate school, I discovered TAPR and the DCC. And I didn't want to leave you all thinking that I was going to destroy amateur radio with my spectrum deregulation thoughts. The deregulation, if it happens, is going to be band by band. We don't have to deregulate it all at once. We just be nice to open up more places to allow more things. And I hope you enjoyed that talk. And are there any questions? I have no idea how long I took. Bruce has had a microphone in his hand for a while.
And I have withdrawal, you know, because I only spoke 45 minutes ago.
And actually, so, Bruce, I actually have been asking people, Bruce is on the talk, but I haven't seen him here today. And I realized I saw your T-shirt at lunch and I was trying to read what it was, but I completely didn't recognize you. You're in disguise.
So what happened was I grew this beard between customer calls. I didn't have consulting for a few weeks. And then I shaved it off and I looked in the mirror and my face was all nose. So I grew back. But anyway, Tim, I think there are some problems with the paradigms that you've used that might help you think about this better. First of all, radio amateurs are the indigenous people of radio. Okay?
That's true.
So we started out, quite literally, we started out owning all of the frequencies that are now at all useful. You know, there was no upper limit to amateur radio, and then slowly our territory was taken from us until we now live only on a few reservations where we have our own semi-autonomous rules.
Yes.
And so we attempt to preserve our way of life and that people can live as we do. The other thing is going back to the stadium metaphor that you used in the very start, I think that you are not really counting on what people do with radio if they can do it. And thus the stadium becomes a stadium full of people with the absolute biggest megaphones that they can buy and an arms race between them. And they, of course, some of them believe that they must save your soul and are talking about that, and some are talking about other things. And finally, I would also have you consider that this stadium is underwater, and that actually gives you your answer, because when you are underwater, the low frequencies can travel very, very far, and the higher frequencies, possibly not far at all. So,
By underwater, you mean
that everyone was in a stadium underwater. Forget that they can't breathe. And that underwater, the very low frequencies are propagating to all of the people. But if they speak in high-pitched voices, only their neighbor can hear them. And so thus, we get to the fact that, first of all, if you don't blind or sunburn people, you can do almost anything with light. And thus, I believe you will see in the near future this problem of 100 people in a small room all trying to use Wi-Fi solved with light instead of Wi-Fi.
Infrared, probably, yes.
Well, or an ultraviolet so high that it isn't a problem. One of those things.
Oh, that would not be eye safe, but yes.
Okay, and and you know, when you're up at 60 gigahertz or something, you do get the capability to construct something like an eye and actually resolve it as an image. But if you look at, for example, 2.4 gig and 5 gig Wi-Fi, you may have noticed that 5 gig just doesn't go so far. But if you're in range, it's very fast and very powerful. So this is all about frequencies.
Yeah, I don't think I there's a little bit in the middle about underwater I didn't quite understand.
Oh, whale song goes for 100 miles or something, but the higher pitches
You can help me understand later. But I think everything you're saying is stuff that I pretty much agree with. But thank you for the first part there. Lots of hands up. Yeah, I'm not sure I'll have answers. If you all have good questions, I'm not sure I'm going to have answers to them.
this is a much shorter but similar comment. And the only thing that your analogy left out for me was power and safety. And the power is, again, the megaphone argument. And I agree there. And one other point in terms of regulation there, there could only be one PA system in that stadium by design. In other words, they wouldn't allow you to bring your new one in. And so that's kind of the thing. And radar could kill you. So just those are the two things that I wanted to comment on.
Yes. And, we have, you know, complete deregulation is not possible. And acoustic is not completely deregulated. When you go to a football stadium and if you try to bring a megaphone with you, they won't let you in with it.
And that's regulation.
That's regulation.
That's the point.
And but I believe the differences between acoustic and electromagnetic would point to the fact that the acoustic needs more regulation. And you're actually getting to the point. I've had these conversations with people. I believe you're absolutely right. Acoustic does need all sorts of regulation that I don't see the reason for in electromagnetic. Acoustic has a safety regulation as well. So there's, you know, certainly within what is needed for safety regulation in acoustic and what's needed for safety regulation in electromagnetic, the communication potential for electromagnetic is, I'm not sure how many, but very many orders of magnitude larger. So, yeah, I don't think I disagree with anything you said there. So many hands up. You've got a microphone. You had the microphone first, probably back there. So,
Tim, I think that you have to think of this entirely differently. You're talking about regulation. Regulation is a function of demand by the public. Okay? So,
and it's mostly
if we have Bluetooth and it works in the car, we use it. If all of us use it at the same time, or if we are uncomfortable with, I'll pick on Bruce being in the car next to me, listening to my Bluetooth, either I have to stop using the Bluetooth or the government's got to change the way Bluetooth is done. We have the same thing occurring right now with drones. Drones weren't a problem until that little chip came out that made them possible to be flown by anybody. And so now we have regulation. Regulation is a function of demand for order. And when we become inorderly, we have regulation to bring order. That to me, and whether it's RF or acoustics, or the fact that I'm getting old and I won't go to restaurants that don't have rugs on the floor and, you know, cloth on the wall so it's not noisy. The young people stay where it's noisy as old farts leave, and we don't go back to that restaurant. That's a form of self-regulation.
Yeah.
And if the restaurateur doesn't understand that, he won't be in business long.
Yes. So regulation is mostly about economics. It's in the case of the radio spectrum, the reason we have the reason we got started with regulation and the reason we still have it today is for economic reasons and public policy reasons related to the economics, because it creates value, because it creates economic opportunities that wouldn't be there if there was potentially chaos. But okay, I guess we should alternate microphones. So we have a mic in the front here.
Hi, I wanted to comment on regulation. There really are, you're talking about two types of regulation. One is rules-based, where there is a rule and it applies to everyone, and the other is franchise-based, where people are given a franchise, for instance, a broadcasting station,
a royal
commercial
patent.
Yeah, right. And that also is, the rules-based is driven from the bottom by consumers, but the franchise-based can really be driven by people who want to make money and who influence regulators to give them a special permission.
Yes. And I I can't remember who originally explained this to me, but sometime in the past 5-ish years, somebody explained to me that there was this whole digital TV transition where all the VHF stations were moving up to UHF channels, but then some of them discovered that they didn't get quite the reach to all the audience that they wanted to. They couldn't, and so they wound up staying on VHF channels or something. But one of the new, there's all sorts, I'm sure lots of you know as much about this as I do. But one of the things I was told, I wish I had a reference for this, was that why do stations, with everybody getting their TV mostly on cable and or from satellite dishes, and there aren't that many people watching TV from over the air, there are still some, but it's not that many, is it really enough for the TV stations to justify the expense of paying for the power for the TV transmitter?
So the PBS stations don't anymore. Yeah.
Don't pay for the power?
The PBS stations, to a great extent, sold off their transmitters and their frequencies and now have sub-channels on other people's HDTV channels.
Okay, so that's just a market happening. But the reason to pay for the power, they said what justifies most TV stations, or many TV stations, or
just a couple more minutes.
To pay for the power to keep, and the transmitter maintenance to keep their transmitter on the air, was because of the must-carry provisions in the FCC regulations for cable TV systems. If you can deliver a signal that could be picked up if somebody put up an antenna on top of their house into some community, then the cable TV operators in that community are required to carry your TV signal on their cable system without charging you for doing so. You can opt out of that and actually say, no, I want I don't want to pay the cable TV system. I want the cable TV system to pay me. I think there's some way you can opt out. But actually, this is like an example of wasted use of spectrum, in the sense that they are keeping their channels and keeping their coverage so that they can get themselves forced onto cable TV systems. That's sad.
Let's take two more questions and then we'll finish up. So we got Ward and we've got...
Yeah, and after that, I'm going to be here until Sunday morning and we can have hallway conversations galore if anybody wants to.
Oh, that's another degree of freedom, isn't it? Yes. I think this is also a very interesting problem to analyze through the lens of risk resource management. And the idea of a demand guarantee of order is really a risk management problem. If I'm going to expend some resources, I want to minimize my risk of unsuccess. And the regulation establishes kind of a market or a space in which you can evaluate that.
So that would be regulation excluding potential competitors to some investment.
Managing the competition in whatever space you've got. And the other frontier here for regulation is really spectral cleanliness. We've worked very hard on our receivers, and amateurs have wonderful receivers, but now we have the problem of transmitted signals contributing in-band noise. It's as if in your stadium analogy, the guy sitting next to you is sneezing and spitting. And so that's the way that they clear out, you know, big fences make good neighbors. But so we have to deal with the transmitters now as well, particularly when we get into SDR and start using inexpensive digitizing mechanisms that generate a lot of noise. So this whole risk resources, and now you've got to deal with the transmitters as well. It's a very interesting talk. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't know as much about economics as I wished. I've never taken a course in economics. I've just learned about it from my friends on the street. So
it's all economics.
Yeah.
Jim, it was a good talk and a lot of interesting things to think about.
Thank you.
To be cynical for a minute, it occurs to me that we won't ever see this sort of deregulation kind of thing happening as long as, A, the government can sell spectrum, and, B, there's a whole lot of federal jobs at the FCC that would go away. But that's the cynical part. The thing about the stadium analogy strikes me is that there's a form of transmitter and receiver coding that goes on, because every voice is a little bit unique and your ears kind of learn to pull that out. And I think the deal here is that's going to be a lot of the solution that's going to make this possible. The third thought, real quick, is that isn't there something similar to this sort of free range deal with what the FCC's done up in UHF with the white spaces, where they created a bunch of space and they make you kind of adaptively figure out what you're going to do and on what frequency? So, you know, when they...
Yeah, but there's a...
It's not exactly the same thing, but it's kind of headed that direction.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the protocol is. You have to detect the presence of the signal in the band with a certain, you know, number of dBs.
You have to look for it, and you also have a table that you look for where there might
be... So this is...
5 gigahertz Wi-Fi, too.
Yeah, actually, it's exactly very interesting that... there's been a gazillion academic papers published on variations on, is it MACA, which was originally published by Phil Karn in this conference. And there's a built-in notion of listen before transmit. And if you listen and it's quiet, then it's okay to transmit. But if you listen and you can hear some power there, well, then you better not transmit because you might interfere. I believe such protocols do not scale because they preclude spatial reuse, which is sort of what's going on in the football stadium when everybody's talking to their neighbor. Once the din of the crowd gets loud enough, people would stop talking because they would be afraid if they're using one of these listen before transmit protocols. I've thought for a while that I need to go write a paper, The Nature of the Din of the Crowd, to try to explain in yet another way some things I was trying to figure out in my PhD thesis, which led to the 100,000 people in the stadium story. But anyway, I think
Steve
wants
to... And I think everybody owes Tim a beer.
I actually don't drink alcohol, but root beer with no caffeine would be cool.
Oh, I would love to see you on caffeine. Let's see if we can get him drunk and on caffeine. I bet he would just... All right, let's a big round of applause. There's probably a real reason why he doesn't drink those things, so now we know. So this is the time in the schedule which we describe as playtime. Basically, it's free time. It's devoted to the demo room to be able to set up your demos and talk with the other peoples with demos. It's also time for you to basically hobnob, take a break, network, share ideas. Around 5:30, start wandering back in the direction where we had lunch to the patio. Not this patio out here, but the patio near the pool, okay? and there will be your meal and dessert and a bartender. As I mentioned, you buy your own alcohol, but TAPR buys your soft drinks, okay? It's scheduled for 5 to 9, and the demo room, if it's empty between 9 to 10, we're going to shut it, which automatically locks it, okay? We'll get started tomorrow morning, 8:45, and then Scotty, if you're presenting tomorrow, get your presentations to Scotty, and he can get them on to the presentation computer. Any quick questions? All right, enjoy.